staying home.
All right, can I have everybody's attention? I know some of you, not all of you. I'm Chris Cleveland. I'm the chairman of the Chicago Republican Party. But today, the most important title is, I am a volunteer on the Ted Cruz campaign. Amen. Now, I have known Ted Cruz for 20 years now. I knew him before he met his wife. We were single together. We were a lot younger back then. And I can tell you, based on knowing him, that this Heidi is the best match I can possibly imagine for her. She is absolutely extremely accomplished, as you may know. She's the daughter of missionaries. She's been around the whole world in many, many different countries. She's an accomplished executive, Harvard MBA.
Wow.
And she served in the Bush administration where she met Cruz, and a wonderful story. Perhaps she'll tell you the story of how she actually met Ted. You know, the press, which isn't always very clever, they tend to say the same things over and over again. And I can't tell you the number of articles that they have written where they have said that Heidi Cruz is the secret weapon, the not-so-secret weapon. She is the Cruz campaign's secret weapon. And it's true. She is the best, absolutely the best asset that this campaign has right now. I saw her speak at the City Club this morning, and she took questions on taxes, the omnibus spending bill, funding for our troops, politics, religious freedom, the Constitution, and she knocked every one of them out of the box. And a few months from now, when she goes to Washington and steps into the White House as our next First Lady, she is going to be the greatest First Lady the nation has ever had. Let me present to you the next First Lady of the United States.
Great state of Illinois, and for finding each and every one of you to join our team. Thank you all for being here. Chris was on board long before the race had narrowed. I think Chris was one of the very first people back last year to come on board when it looked like it might be tough in the Chicago area, and he has turned this around.
Wow.
With his standing up for what he knows to be right, standing behind the Constitution, speaking out. Probably at your own peril at times, for someone who a lot of people didn't know in this area. And you always know who's with you so early, and we are eternally grateful and can't thank you enough. You've been far too generous to me. My only job on this campaign is to help Ted win. Let me just take a minute to give you three things that I hope can be helpful to you as you do all the hard work of elections this week. This is the most important week of the election. You know that. That is why the rooms that I've visited, the offices, the neighborhoods in Illinois have been full this week, because people are giving sacrificially of their time away from their jobs, their schools, their families, to ensure that this state has the opportunity to see the values, the principles, the policy, and the character of the person who they will vote for. So thank you for being on the tip of that spear. And if I can give you three things to help make that job easier this week, I would love to do so. And the first is, I want to tell you just a couple things about Ted that caused me to fall in love with him. Because voting is a duty, and it's something that we all should do because we're America and we have the opportunity. But if you can cause people to go vote because they've truly fallen in love with you, Ted, they will not only vote, they will ask 5, 10, 20 other people to go vote to make sure that we have the right person. The second thing that I want to do is to tell you what Ted has been doing and will do for our country when he is here. And the last thing, how we win. How we win on Tuesday, how we win thereafter, how we win the general against the Democrat. because that is why we're here. We are here to beat Hillary Clinton and put a strong constitutional conservative in the White House.
Amen. 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 Woo!
About how we met. So I grew up in California. Don't hold it against me. I live in a beautiful place where we have to live with people who think very differently than we do, so I understand. But I grew up on the Central Coast. It was really Reagan country in the 70s. My parents were medical missionaries in Africa. We grew up firsthand seeing real poverty, people who really struggle, who don't have the hope of being part of a country with promise. I grew up in with parents who truly practice what they preach. They believe in hard work. My brother and I grew up weeding corn and picking berries, trimming trees. When we were little, we asked for a little chore money, and my dad said, well, why don't you go start a business? That's how it's done in this country. So when I was 6 and my brother was 8, we baked bread. We ended up doing about 4 hours a day for about 10 years. We started out together. We separated our companies. We competed. He hired me. I figured out it was better work for myself than for him. We branched out. We competed again. I learned so much before going to high school about some basic qualities that are so true of our country. When I went to Texas to work on the George W. Bush campaign, who campaigned as a fiscal, social, and national security conservative, I met Ted, and I knew I had met more than my match after working with him for just a couple days. Ted is compelling. He is compelling. And I fell in love with him in that first week. He was raised by a man who came here with nothing, $100, who washed dishes for 50 cents an hour, who didn't speak the language, who was a math major so he could pass his classes, who was a brilliant student, who was a freedom fighter. Rafael Cruz understands that the way we protect ourselves from tyranny is through elections. And he is passionate every electoral cycle, even when his son is not. Ted's mother was the first in her family to ever go to college. Her family were all working for the DuPonts and the factories. And her father did not believe that women should receive an education. And she differed. She went down and enrolled in one of the best universities in the country and graduated with a degree in math in 1956. This is a woman who's implacable. She is very confident. She has incredible judgment and wisdom. And to this day, I tell Texans that their U.S. Senator has one person that he really listens to, even more than me, and that is his mother. He has wonderful qualities. But the three things that just were so compelling about Ted that I think are relevant to this election are how incredibly principled he is. He was raised on the Constitution and the Bible. He knows what he believes, and he knows how to articulate it in such a common sense, practical way. The second thing is the courage that Ted has. He has fought and done exactly what he said he would do for 27 million Texans, and it is why last Tuesday, Ted won Texas with a 17-point
margin.
I know him best came out in big numbers, and I've just been overwhelmed by the incredible support for Ted around this country from people that haven't even met him. And I can tell you it's well placed, because those of us who know him best have left Texas and come out and campaigned for him to tell people in Illinois and Iowa and South Carolina and the South and clear up to Alaska and Maine who this person is. And when you really know someone, you know that you can trust them. The last thing that I just want to tell you about Ted is how thoughtful he is. You don't get to see on the debate stage those private moments. You know, an hour before that South Carolina debate at 7:04 p.m., Ted came into the hotel room, and I thought he probably needed something, so I jumped up to help. We were getting ready and getting the girls ready, and he came in to bring us flowers and chocolates because the next day was Valentine's. This is an hour before that debate. This is a person who truly is centered. He's not hauling policy briefing books around. He knows what he believes. He has an incredible command of the issues, such that he has time to think that tomorrow's Valentine's. So there are so many moments in this. He's also very smart. There are so many moments where Ted adds a light moment into the campaign. He calls every couple days just to sing and tell me that he loves me. And it might be in the middle of something big going on. And it reminds you of why this person is prepared to be Commander-in-Chief on day one, because of his centeredness, because of his brilliance, his articulate nature. It just is who he is every day. He has time to think beyond, way, way beyond himself and all of these issues. So that's who Ted is. He has this incredible combination of qualities. Ted knows that this country is in crisis. He knows that as we travel the country, we see people that the Great Recession was 8 years ago. We still have people that haven't gotten back on their feet, that aren't fully employed, we're graduating students from college that don't have job offers. We're sending our young men and women abroad to wars that don't have a specific goal, that seem to have no end. Ted is running on three things. The first is safety. He will keep our country safe by building a strong military with training and equipment, by honoring our vets when they return, and reforming the VA to be performance-based. Ted will always put U.S. national security interests first, and will ask, do we have a U.S. national security interest there? Because if not, we should build the strongest military ever and hope to never need to use it. That is why we need to build such a big threat in our military that no one will dare cross us. And then we use that bully pulpit of peace that Reagan did so well, speaking out for peace and freedom. We are the only nation on earth that goes and fights to free our, to keep ourselves free and others, and we don't take over land, we don't invade. We are simply doing it because the principles of what we are doing. The second thing is growth. It is this economic issue. When people are doing well, people can come together. We have 1% growth in this economy last quarter. We need to get back to when we had strong levels of growth. And remember, when Ronald Reagan took office, the country was in bad shape. And in just a few years, we had 7% growth in the U.S. economy. We do that through reforming taxes to a flat tax. Ted has a specific plan with a 10% flat tax for individuals, and by dramatically reducing the size of the regulatory state. And the third thing is, we must defend our constitutional liberty.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah.
The right to keep and bear arms, privacy, and the 10th Amendment, where we return power to the states. Where we remember that our federal government is bloated, we need to return power to the states. We need to abolish all these recent departments that have only been in existence for a handful of decades, and return power to the states. We need to abolish the Department of Education, get rid of Common Core, and return power to the states. We need to abolish the Department of Energy and let states decide. There is so much economic growth in this country due to energy, and we need to unleash those forces. We need to dramatically reduce the scope of the EPA, who keeps trying to think of things to do to regulate you, your neighborhoods, and your cities. So much of this can be done in a day. When you know the power of the presidency and the limits on presidential power, you can change things quickly. And Ted has said, and I'll end with this before I talk about how we win. In one day, the first thing that he will do is rescind every illegal executive order.
Amen. Awesome.
Work through his economic team on a flat tax and be able to start the work of abolishing the IRS. This deal with Iran has been opposed by 80% of the American people. He will ask the Department of Justice to launch an investigation into Planned Parenthood. No one has been a stronger supporter of the Jewish people and the nation of Israel. To its rightful place in Jerusalem. So how do we get this done? That's only day one. Then there's 4 years and maybe 8 years. So this is a person that's actually going to do what they say they're going to do. And how do we win? We win through each of you. Ted can't win this race by himself, but this is a movement. This movement started years ago. It has been succeeding. It has made it okay to question the status quo, the establishment, to say, we are going to make DC listen. And Ted has been a champion of that movement, because all of you rose up and said, let us remind, politics is not a career. It's not a thing where you go and you try to do things and come back and explain why nothing can be done. It is something for a point in time. It is a job where the person that gets elected works for you. You only, you hold them accountable to solve problems and get out of the way. And we need to return to that kind of leadership. So we win through the grassroots army that we've built. We've had a bigger grassroots army than any campaign. This country volunteering right now. We had 12,000 people in Iowa, a similar number in the early states, and we also have to raise the money to go the distance. You know, most campaigns have a very moderate candidate who's going to run to the middle in a general and then lose to the Democrats.
Yep.
And they have all the money. This campaign has been different. There's a number of really good people that have dropped out and are coalescing around the conservative in the race, and we have all the money.
Yep.
We have raised from over a million people in this country, mostly online, with an average donation size of about $65. We're the only campaign to have had funds from all people in all states, and also have a big effort with people who can max out, because people are doing the most that they can. And that's different for all of us, and that's how we win, by each one of us maxing out. So thank you. Thank you for your incredible effort. Thank you for turning out the state of Illinois. Remind people that you talk to that you have to vote for the delegate. Good luck on phone banking, block walking. I do it with you. I do it in every state that I'm in. The girls have had fun. Caroline is 7 and Catherine's 5, and they've been block walking. This is where we won elections in this last week. And yesterday we were in Central and South Illinois. Huge turnout. We can get a big share of the delegates in this state because of your hard work. So with that, thank you. I look forward to meeting you.
Thank you.
Of course, we have Christine Redonio, our minority leader senator. Mike Fricolone, Will County Board. Jeff Ragone, president, Lockport Township Parks Board. Mike Lewandowski, Lockport Township trustee. Tim Kalaitis, Plainfield Township chairman. Chuck Klein, Wheatland Township supervisor. Edward Rinkowski, he's our Will County Republican chair. Ray Rossi, Will County judge. Annette Parker, Will County board. John Selinsky, Lockport Township Highway Commissioner. And Lori McPhillips, Will County executive candidate. Also had Kristen Cross, Will County recorder candidate. Did I miss anybody? I miss anyone? I'd like to, I know Christine's on a schedule, and we all know how hard she works out in Springfield. Jim Eustace, Will County Board. Another guy works hard. Christine, if I could get you to say a few words, I'd appreciate it.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. It's great to see so many old friends. I actually don't have Lockport Township anymore, but I'm seeing people now from Frankfort, Mokena, New Lenox, many of the areas that I used to have. So I appreciate everybody being here tonight. If ever there's a time that Republicans need to pull together, now is the time. I know there's a lot of tumultuousness in the state at the moment, so I'm going to talk about that first. I'll talk away in a little bit on the presidential. And then probably get on my way. As you know, the state is in a significant state of dysfunction. That's, I think, the best word to describe it. We've had no budget now for 9 months. That's an unprecedented amount of time. Unfortunately, most of the money coming into the state is being spent on autopilot through court orders, consent decrees, and continuing appropriations. The three areas, the main areas that are not covered by all that, are very important areas, and that's education, higher education, and human services. Some of the most important functions that the state has. The problem with not having a budget and keeping us on autopilot is we're spending $36 billion a year and we only have $32 billion a year coming in. We are accumulating debt at the rate of $13 million every single day. That's $400 million a month and $500 million a year. So for all the needs that go wanting, what would $13 million a day or $400 million a month do? A lot. That's why it's so critical to get a budget. Unfortunately, I believe Democrats are really playing politics with this. They like this dysfunction. They think they can turn it around to blame Republicans and somehow get an electoral advantage out of it. I will single out specifically the Speaker, who I think is even less willing to even enter into any discussions than the Senate president, who we at least are trying to figure out a way to maybe get him to have to move on some of these important issues. So actually putting the state of the state above the politics, which is hard to do, we're political folks. But we will be trying to do that over the next two, we have a 2 week break after next week. The House, as you know, is not for a month. They're just taking a vacation for a month for the primaries, all politics. So, which it's very unfortunate. When we go into the election cycle, of course, the top of the ticket's going to be very important for what happens in our House and Senate races. The governor, clearly, and myself would like to pick up seats. I can tell you, I think in the Senate, we will pick up at least one seat. We are fortunate enough to have a district in Western Illinois that has no Democrat running and is had a Democrat rep, so we should pick that one up. Every Republican we pick up strengthens our governor and the fundamental changes that he's trying to get into place. So that will be good. The problem is what's going to be at the top of the ticket, and we don't know. What I do know is I hope that we are unified, whoever it is, because it's going to be tough going if the party is split. I am the statewide coordinator for John Kasich. I mean, he's a guy that I think has got the experience and the temperament to do the job. But if he's not the guy, I'm going to be with whoever it is. And some people say are big boosters of Trump. Some people say publicly, Republicans, that it can't be him. I hope we don't do that. I hope that if it is Trump, he surrounds himself with some great people, and we're all able to pull together in the right direction. We need to be unified. So I'd say work as hard as you can for the candidate that you want, but at the end of the day, we've got to get together. It's the only way that we can move the ball forward. So once again, I appreciate the opportunity to see so many old friends and see some new folks that haven't been involved. And thank you for being here. I know it's not always the most enjoyable thing to come out to a political event on a Tuesday or a Thursday night, but your involvement really, really makes a difference, and I deeply appreciate it. If ever you need to get a hold of me, my door is open. Just Google me, and you'll find plenty of phone numbers. I try to return calls, and I'll make sure that I do that. So again, thanks for the opportunity. And thanks, Jim, for a great event.
Thank you, Christine. Take your time out of your busy schedule to talk with us. Really, really, truly appreciate it. All right, at this time, please step over to the buffet. And